When people say, well, why do we sleep? It's a bit like asking, well, why are we awake? There's a whole bunch of essential stuff going on that is not just an indulgence or a luxury, but essential for our ability to function.
You've sort of slightly poo-pooed chamomile tea, but if you're having trouble sleeping and you don't want to resort to sort of pharmacological methods.
Yeah, melatonin, of course, is very widely taken. And melatonin is often called quite inappropriately the sleep hormone. And it most emphatically is not a sleep hormone. It's a biological marker of the dark.
In terms of sleep as a branch of science, is it something which was sort of, has it become less peripheral perhaps than it used to be?
Yes, I think it has, and I think that it's very interesting because sleep was always part very much of medicine. And neuroscientists or circadian biologists like myself would never go to a sleep meeting. And essentially what it was a lot of clinicians putting electrodes onto the surface of the skull and measuring electroencephalograms and correlating that with other stuff. But over the past 10, 15 years, neuroscientists have moved into the field, into the space. And it's quite interesting, circadian scientists like myself, I'm a neuroscientist working on the body clock and how the clock is regulated, have also moved into sleep. So we bring our sort of neuroscience reductionist cellular molecular perspective to sleep. And so I think sleep has changed enormously. And certainly when I set up the Sleep and Circadian Neuroscience Institute, I wanted to bring the two disciplines together.
And as a result of that, what's might we understand about sleep now that we might not have done a decade ago?
I think we understand the immense complexity of sleep, that sleep is or the sleep consciousness cycle is an interaction of all the key brain neurotransmitter systems and multiple brain structures, all interacting. So the hindbrain, the hypothalamus, the midbrain, the cortex, all interacting to generate the two states. And then those two states are regulated by the circadian system. Now is the appropriate time to be asleep. Now is the appropriate time to be awake. And another timer, which is perhaps the most intuitive part about sleep, which is the homeostatic drive. Essentially, the longer you've been awake, the greater the buildup of sleep pressure and the greater the need to sleep. And so we're beginning to understand how those regulators, and in addition, light, are all feeding in to this complex system. And in fact, one could argue that sleep-wake is a global brain event. And indeed, good sleep is a metric of good brain health overall, because it essentially is the integrative product of so much stuff that's going on within the brain.
I guess, to what extent are we in the dark as to knowing exactly what happens whilst we're asleep?
Well, I think the exciting thing, again, over the past few years is that we now understand what's going on within the brain to some extent. That we really didn't know before. So, for example, memory formation and consolidation. We now know that that's taking place in the brain whilst we sleep. And it's not just the laying down of facts. What's turned out to be truly fascinating is that we problem solve whilst we're asleep. And some beautiful work recently has shown that a night of sleep can enormously enhance our capacity to solve problems. It goes from without sleep or about 20% to after sleep, 70% improvement in problem solving. The ability to clear toxins from the brain. There's a lot of work at the moment on this misfolded protein, beta amyloid, which has been linked to dementia and Alzheimer's. And we know that that is packaged up and cleared from the brain whilst we sleep. And individuals who are sleep deprived show high levels of deposition and accumulation of beta amyloid within the brain. The realignment of metabolic pathways, the compartmentalization of energy reserves, essentially so much that allows us to function during the day is going on whilst we sleep. And without sleep, of course, our ability to function during the day falls apart incredibly quickly. And so when people say, well, why do we sleep? It's a bit like asking, well, why are you awake? There's a whole bunch of essential stuff going on that is not just an indulgence or a luxury, but essential for our ability to function. How do you know if you're not getting enough sleep? Well, if you're dependent upon an alarm clock to wake you up or another person, if you're oversleeping at weekends, if you're taking a long time to wake up and feel alert, if you feel that you need a mid-afternoon nap, if you're dependent upon caffeinated drinks, if you receive advice from friends and family saying you're being overly impulsive, you know, your mood is changing, you know, you've lost that empathy and sense of humor. And if you start to experience anxiety and worry, these are all things that are very indicative that you're not getting enough sleep. And then you need to find ways of prioritizing it.
In terms of trying to develop a sleep hygiene, which I think is a sort of buzz term at the moment.
Sleep education, sleep hygiene,
To kind of maximize your quality and quantity of sleep, is there a particularly ideal routine to follow before bedtime?
You could divide one's actions up into four domains. One is, what can you do during the day? What should you do immediately before bed, the half an hour to an hour before bed? And what should the bedroom be like? And what should you do in bed? And it's all kind of stuff that our grandparents would have said to us. During the day, you've got to get enough morning light to set the clock. You've got to exercise, but try not to make it too close to bedtime. Avoid excessive consumption of caffeine. Certainly don't drink caffeine in the afternoon. And also winding down and stepping back from the working day. You can't flip into the state of consciousness and sleep without some sort of winding down.
What should the cutoff point for caffeine be in the day?
I would say that the half-life of caffeine, which is how long it, you know, remains in the body, is between 5 to 9 hours, depending upon the state of your liver. So a rule of thumb would be not much after 2 o'clock in the afternoon would be my suggestion. But if you're drinking caffeine into the early evening, it's almost certainly, and some people are more sensitive than others, going to delay sleep onset at night.
What are the foods which might induce sleep and which foods might hinder sleep?
You raise a really important issue. And so the whole area of circadian rhythms and metabolism has exploded over the past few years. And it's been shown that if you concentrate your calories during the first half of the day, breakfast and lunch, that tends to be cleared from the system. You know, the glucose goes up and you clear it from the system. But if you're eating a lot of calories towards bedtime, then that glucose can hang around much longer. It's not cleared. You don't have the insulin which gets rid of it. And that can predispose to things like diabetes too. And of course, obesity and all the other problems that you'd have. So really, you should be having, you know, light meals during the second half of the day, certainly before bedtime. It's not what we do. You know, society has changed, you know, from our Victorian ancestors, where the main meal of the day was lunchtime, dinner time, you know. But now it's shifted to much later. And that's, of course, because we've been able to invade the night with cheap, safe electricity. So we've invaded the night and we've shifted the entire day and our eating habits much later. But that's a very recent phenomenon. What do we know about foods that can help you sleep? Well, there's arguments that a milky drink can be useful or other agents, and it's probably a placebo effect. There's very little evidence base to anything, you know, including chamomile tea and all of the traditional ways. But they're great in the sense they're drinks without caffeine, and that's important. But randomized controlled trials that you would want to undertake as if it were a drug have not really been undertaken. But as I say, it may well have a placebo effect, and if it works for you, use it. And I think that's the real rule of thumb, which is do what works for you.
If you're peckish before bed, a banana, do you think? Or
that can be good. I mean, ideally try and avoid high sugar or high fat go for protein. And you know, you raise a very good point about, you know, what should night shift workers have? And of course, they have high levels of diabetes too, obesity, coronary heart disease, and all the rest of it. And it's quite extraordinary that employers don't make any provision for that. So they provide, you know, fast food, canteen food, snack bars, you know, full of sugar and fat. And really what you should be going for is small protein-rich snacks. Try and keep to a routine. You know, try both on free days and work days. You know, it's going to be a bit of flexibility, but try not to have, you know, 3 hours later on one night compared to the other night. Sure, the bed is large enough and it's comfortable. I mean, there's a big investment, I think, from the commercial sector in developing much better beds. And that's great. I think many of us have ignored our beds and our bedding for a long time. Before bed, you know, you need to reduce the light levels. Increased light will increase alertness and therefore reduce the time it takes to get to sleep. Stop using those apps, those electronic devices and televisions. Don't use alcohol or antihistamines to sedate yourself. These are not biological mimics for sleep. They are sedatives. Adopt behaviors that relax you. You know, have a routine whereby you may be listening to music quietly or whatever. And so you sort of get into the right state. You might want to have a bath, for example. That can be relaxing. Then the bedroom shouldn't be too warm. It should be around 18, 22 degrees, but not warmer. Keep it quiet, keep it dark, remove all of those tempting devices, such as TVs, from the bedroom if you can. Don't clock watch. It's really, people get very anxious and they sort of will keep on looking at the clock, particularly if they wake up. And you don't really need to know that information. And so I've suggested to some people just cover up their clock, just set the alarm if you need it. And really be very careful about sleep apps. Sleep apps are largely unvalidated. And when I say that, I mean that they've done sort of, they've looked at 8 university students for a day, compared it to classical. And that's the sort of level of validation. Many of these companies have failed to engage with the scientific community. And so I think what the apps are very good for are telling you roughly when you went to sleep, roughly when you got up, and how many times you got up in the night. But if they start talking about REM sleep versus non-REM sleep, or you had good sleep or deep sleep, that's useless. And people have come up to me after public talks and said, I'm not getting any slow wave sleep. Am I going to die? And then they get terribly, I kid you not, one person actually came up to me and said, I don't think I'm getting enough slow wave sleep. So I'm setting my alarm for 3 o'clock in the morning to see how much slow wave sleep I've accumulated during. And so they can be very anxiety inducing. The final bit would be, if you wake, stay calm. So many people sort of will wake up and think, oh my God, that's it. I may as well start drinking coffee and doing emails. Whereas in fact, a single consolidated block of sleep is not the norm, probably in our society. Like all other animals, we have polyphasic or biphasic sleep. So you wake up, most of the time we're unaware that we've woken up. We then go back into the next sleep cycle. And so that's the key thing. I mean, you may want to get sort of, if you really can't just get straight back to sleep, then remove yourself from the bed. Don't lie there frustrated. Go and again listen under to some music or some, read a few pages of a book under dim light, and when you start to feel tired again, go back. But don't abandon sleep. I mean, I think so many people do. And if you look at societies without electricity, for example, that's exactly what happens. They will wake up, interact, then go back to sleep again. So those are the sorts of ways in which you can behaviorally improve your sleep.
In terms of the natural supplements which are out there, you've sort of slightly poo-pooed chamomile tea, but are there, you know, if you're having trouble sleeping and you don't want to resort to sort of pharmacological methods?
Yeah, melatonin, of course, is very widely taken. And melatonin is often called quite inappropriately the sleep hormone. And it most emphatically is not a sleep hormone. It's a biological marker of the dark. So shortly before dark, melatonin levels from the pineal begin to rise. They're high throughout the night, and then in anticipation of morning, they come down again. And in fact, the melatonin release expands and contracts over the seasons as day length or night length increases and decreases. And many mammals, deer, sheep, use that expanding and contracting melatonin profile to time their reproduction. So the rut in autumn is because day length is shortened, night length is increased, you've got a more melatonin release, and that's triggered reproduction. We don't seem to be influenced by melatonin in that way. So what do we actually know in us? 3 milligrams of melatonin before bed, half an hour before intended bedtime, can probably slightly reduce the time it takes to get to sleep in about 70% of people. But we're only talking about 10 minutes or so. So it's a very mild effect. If it works, great. There's no real evidence that it's harmful. People have eaten grams of the stuff and had no obvious side effects. I guess my feeling would be try and avoid anything, even something like melatonin. And certainly, for example, airline pilots are told not to take melatonin. And the problem is, if you don't know where the clock is, then you actually might take it at the wrong biological time. And even though it has a mild effect, it might actually interfere with the body's natural processing.
Interesting. But if you woke up in the middle of the night, would a low dose of melatonin help you at 2 a.m?
It might do, yes. In 70% of people, it can probably sort of ease them back into sleep. But trying to disentangle its genuine effects from its placebo effects is tricky. And if people feel that melatonin will work, they'll say, I'm now going to get some sleep. They become more relaxed, less anxious, and therefore much more inclined to let the biological sleep sort of enfold them. One of the great problems is if your partner snores, and it may just be snoring, which is okay, and earplugs, I guess, is one solution. You've got to be careful that they don't have obstructive sleep apnea, which is where they actually stop breathing for a bit because the musculature of the throat has closed. And that can be a real problem because the brain realizes it's being starved of oxygen. It then wakes you up, and there's this huge great gasp and this huge surge in blood pressure, which can be very bad for small vessels in the eye, for example. It can damage them. But what do you do about a snoring partner? And if you can't stand earplugs, well, if there's an alternative sleeping space, go for it. It doesn't reflect on the nature of the relationship. In fact, the relationship could improve because you're getting better sleep, and therefore the wake time is better together.